I bring you greetings from Chicago and the ICLS. It's great to be with you guys. It's great to be back here. Jason and I won't be here on Sunday. We'll be in Orange County, so I'm so grateful to be with you guys tonight. But the ICLS was amazing. It was by far the best one yet. And the lessons were incredible, all the speaking, the fellowship, it was just an incredible production. It was the best one yet. And pray, because next year the ICLS will be here in Chicago, or LA! My brain is still in Chicago. No, I'm just kidding. Sadvi is visiting from Miami. She's still on her vacation. She's still in Chicago too. No, I'm kidding. But it's great to have you with us. We're gonna pull an audible and have her do the close today. So we're happy to have you here. Welcome. But tonight, me and Lindsay and Edie are all gonna share a lesson together and talk about what we got out of the ICLS. I'm just gonna share the lesson I did at the ICLS with you guys. So there's that. So our title is called Blessed, and we have 3 points. The first point is blessed to have friends for a lifetime. That's what I'm going to talk about. And then Edie's going to talk about blessed or too obsessed. Okay, so I don't know. I'm looking forward to hearing that. And then number 3.3, blessed to be righteous. Lindsay's going to share that, and I know that's going to be amazing. Linda Moreno, of course, her and Raul are our world sector leaders. They lead the Latin America world sector and the movement, but it's so incredible because she gave me this lesson. She really, honestly, I came to the ICLS with a completely different lesson on my heart. It was done. I was ready to go. And then I was talking to Linda, and she just shared a scripture with me and kind of what a lesson that she did. And I was like, well, that's really awesome. Forget my lesson. I'm going to do yours. So this is what I learned. I learned this too, and I preached it. So there you go. You're welcome. Also, side note, now we have Canada in the world sector here, so we sort of need a new name. I don't know, just gonna throw that out there. Maybe you guys can help us find a new name. Think about it, let us know. Point number one, blessed to have friends for a lifetime. So spiritual friendship is so different than worldly friendships. You know, God intends us to be friends with spiritual friends with each other and to help each other feel loved, feel supported in what we do and how we serve God and really every area, to help each other in our walks with God, and ultimately to help each other get to heaven. That's what it's all about. And so what I wanted to do real quick is just share about some of my friends. Just going to share about some of my friends. So I was baptized in 2001 in Portland, Oregon. And I was baptized into a very small church. So some of you guys may have been baptized in a bigger church, or like this, a bigger region, super region. And maybe you came in and you're like, wow, I can't wait to get to know all these amazing, incredible women that I just know are going to be best friends for a lifetime. That was not necessarily my heart, okay? When I became a Christian, again, it was a small church. I looked around and I was like, all these people look really amazing, but I got God for my best friend, but that's probably about it. I don't know if you guys can relate. I just never would have picked any of these women for my friends in the world. Do you know what I mean? Am I alone on this? I don't know. I can't be the only one with a bad heart when I became a Christian. I was super worldly, okay? I'm just being honest. But what's so encouraging is that God determines the times and the places that, of course, we live and move and have our being. Yes, you know that scripture, but God actually determines who our friends are going to be through those times and places. He just knew. The day that I was baptized, it just so happens that I also moved into a sister's household the very same day, and lo and behold, who was my roommate but Michelle Williamson? Now, some of you may not know her, but her and her husband, Michael, lead the church in London and the European world sector. And it's just so cool that we became really good friends, and we would have morning prayer times together, and we would talk, and, you know, it was amazing. We were bonded in an incredible way. I ended up living with them in Vancouver, Washington, and they taught me what a real, like, a spiritual family should look like. and really encouraged my heart in that way. I watched their son, Michael Adrian, changed his diaper. Now he preached with his girlfriend at the ICLS. I mean, I was just blown away. I'm like, Michael Adrian gave me so much vision for my babies, you know? And then we planted the London church together in 2010. That was so amazing. And she discipled me for umpteen years. I don't even know. But little did I know that the day that I was baptized and I moved into that household, that we would be friends for a lifetime. And really, they were my parents in the faith. Another sister in that small church in Portland, Oregon, was Colleen Chaloner. And her husband, Ricky, lead the churches in Southeast Asia. They're actually here this week, so I think they're going to be in Orange County preaching, but they're all around here. They'll be here, I think, on Thursday. But she was a teen, and I was in the campus ministry. And so we became instant buddies and friends. And then later, years later, Jason and I discipled them when they led the Portland church, and that bonded us even more. And I'm so inspired by Colleen. She's one of my heroes in the faith. I mean, she's led the church in Manila, Southeast Asia, like incredible disciple. Little did I know when I was baptized that this little teen girl would become one of my best friends for a lifetime. Another sister, Amy Charmella. Amy studied the Bible with me. She flat laid me out, told me I was super impure the way I was dressed. I mean, I was a mess. I came to one of the studies with like a little crop top and like holes, and she's like, okay, we're not going to do that study. We're going to talk about purity. I love Amy. Jeremy and Amy are amazing, and they're shepherds in our church here in Orange County, and he does so much with the cyber ministry, and to this day, she's a lifelong friend, and just a confidant, someone that she's a safe place. Do you know what I mean? Just incredible. Who would have thought? I wouldn't have. I think that's my whole point. I hope that if you're looking around, you're like, I don't know that I can relate. It's okay. God has determined the times and the places for you to have best friends for a lifetime. But that's just one example in my life of God providing friendships, relationships. I don't have time to share about all the other lifelong friends and other situations and other ministries or churches I've been in or discipling part. Do you know what I mean? There's so many. That's just one instance. The very first memory that I've had in the kingdom, the very first year, that's just one. But there's so many. And I think what I want to share a story in the Bible, a relationship that brought God so much glory. Women that became friends for a lifetime. And that's Elizabeth and Mary. So turn with me to Luke chapter 1, and we don't have time, so a quick run-up, and I think you guys probably know some of this story, right? But Elizabeth is in her sixth month of pregnancy, and, you know, with John the Baptist, and Mary was just told by an angel as a virgin that she was going to give birth to the Son of God. Pretty incredible. Let's pick up Luke chapter 1, verse 39. So the Bible says, at that time, Mary got ready and hurried to a town in the hill country of Judea, where she entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. In a loud voice, she exclaimed, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear. But why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me? As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. Blessed is she who has believed the Lord that would fulfill the promises to her." So this is an amazing passage, right? And here, Elizabeth and Mary were cousins. So that's pretty cool. How cool is that? They're both chosen relatives to have miracle babies. You know, Elizabeth because, well, she's just old. And then Mary because she was a virgin. Miracle babies. Incredible. I mean, God determined them, the times and the places, for them to be used to do incredible things for God and to have that friendship. So there's three things I want to talk about here. I don't have 3 points because I have 1 point technically. So 3 things real quick about this passage. One, relationships should strengthen each other spiritually. That's why God gave you the women sitting next to you. The Bible says here that Mary hurried to Elizabeth. She couldn't wait to be with her, to hug her, to love her, to spend time with her, to share the good news that she's pregnant. She was filled with joy. And when Elizabeth heard Mary, she had a physical reaction of joy. The baby in her womb leaped. Can you imagine? The baby just leaping for joy. Now, side note, this is a whole nother lesson, but God had a plan for John and Jesus, both babies, in the future to also do something great for God. So that's pretty cool. But she was filled with the Holy Spirit when they came together. And God's strength and presence was felt, and it just encouraged Elizabeth. Hopefully that's how you guys felt today when you saw each other, right? Gave each other big hugs, and you just felt strengthened, and you hear the good news, and you're singing together as a family, and prayerfully you walk out feeling edified and strengthened by the relationships in this room. I mean, that's why it's so important to come to Midweek. Maybe you were dragging your feet, and you're like, oh, I've got homework, or I've got this, or I've got that, but we're here to strengthen each other. And I believe that's what God does when we're together. We're strengthened and we're consumed by the Holy Spirit. When we hear each other, we see each other, and we spend time. And then Elizabeth says in a loud voice, blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear. Elizabeth's heart was to encourage Mary, encourage her friend. And that's what she did. And that's the heart we've got to have towards our roommates, towards those in our Bible talk, towards all the sisters in this room. Okay, and then the next thing we see is that there's to be a humility in our relationships, right? Elizabeth was older, but she took a humble attitude towards Mary. She says, verse 43, why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me? You know? I mean, she knew that Mary was the mother of her Lord, that Mary was younger than her, but God chose Mary to bear our Lord. She had so much faith. Isn't that amazing? And she was humble. I mean, there was no competition here. There was no insecurity. There was no fear. It wasn't about titles. It wasn't about age. It was just purity and humility. And that's how we're to be with each other. It is hot in here. I'm so sorry. Where's the fan? I'm just kidding. Okay, I gotta admit, I was a little zealous this week when I took my kids to school. I was like, ooh, it's fall. It is not fall, homies. I don't know why I'm wearing this sweater. I just want, where's my pumpkin spice latte? I'm not right. Okay, I'm sorry. We've got like a month. Thank you. Gosh. Give it up for Ashley. I'm dying. Last thing, I gotta move on here. Depth in our relationships. We're to have depth in our relationships in the kingdom. We're to be close. Mary stayed for 3 months. Can you imagine? 3 months. Just to be together. And during that time, I think they laughed. They built memories. They prayed. They cried. They shared all their fears and insecurities. I mean, they just bonded as women do. Isn't that amazing? And also Zechariah, side note, he couldn't talk. So I think God was really trying to encourage Elizabeth. Look at that story later. But for me, there's so many relationships I have. I'm so grateful for Amanda Miller. She's in Salt Lake City. We've known each other for years. We went on the New York mission team together. And she comes here often for her job. And so I'm always like, stay with me. She stays with me. We stay up super late. We're exhausted the next day. But I feel like a teenager, in the campus ministry again, just hanging out with my buddy. And I'm so grateful for her. We literally strengthen each other. She's one of my discipling partners, and it's not on paper. Do you know what I mean? I was so encouraged to be at the conference because, you know, we were talking to Vinny and Bia, who lead the church in Brazil, and they're so cute because they get an Airbnb with all their buddies, like Danilo and Carol and Tulio and Vaitza. They all grew up together spiritually in Brazil, and so when they come to these conferences, they're all in different churches, but they just get an Airbnb and they hang out. Like, two of them are pregnant. What are you guys doing? They just want to hang out. Do you know what I'm saying? They're just strengthened by each other. At our marriage retreat, Edie and Regine, I won't say who, I won't use the names, but do you know that some of the women at a marriage retreat stayed together with their husbands in hotel rooms? I mean, I don't condone that. No, I'm just kidding. I think it's fine. Honestly, I wasn't going to share this, but it's pretty awesome if you think about it. Do you know what I mean? Like, they're at a marriage retreat, and they just want to hang out together. These guys grew up spiritually together, and that's why. I just think what we have in the kingdom, guys, is so rare, and it's so special. And I just think in the same way we need each other, the friendships in this room are provided by God to help. This is really helping me. I'm so grateful for you. I'm going to leave this up here for you, Edie. But I just want to encourage you guys, let's go deeper in our D groups. You know, and that's just be friends. Let's connect. let's go beyond this room tonight and get those times with each other. The women I disciple, well, I'm grateful for Linda. She's my discipler. She was my discipler back in 2010 when I led my first region. And guess what? She never stopped discipling me. I call her all the time. And now she's officially discipling me again. But it was so natural. I'm so grateful for Linda. She's one of my best friends. I'm grateful for the women I disciple. I talk to them like I talk to Linda. We're friends. We're partners. And we truly help each other find strength in God spiritually. I always tell people, you need to have 5 best friends in the kingdom. If you have more friends in the world, you're not going to make it. And that's the problem. Your best friends are here. You just got to give your heart and be open to the fact that God's determined the times and the places. I feel blessed by God for my relationships. There's almost not a day that goes by that truly I thank God for my relationships and my friends in the kingdom. Maybe that's why God gave me this lesson, because I'm just so grateful. I have a lot to share. Can you say the same? I hope and I pray that you are connected and that you have best friends in this room. And if not, I just want to encourage you, remember, God's determined the times and places. Don't look beyond your Bible talk. Don't look beyond your household. Don't look beyond your discipler or those you disciple. Those are the best friends that God has intended for you to have for a lifetime. I love you guys. Thanks for letting me share.
Well, hi, ladies. I, too, am also super grateful to have had the opportunity. We're going to act like this is like a second mic. It really does help. But the opportunity to go to the ICLS in Chicago, and I'm grateful for the opportunity to really share just what stood out to me and what I learned from it. And one of my favorite lessons that really cut to the heart was a lesson that Linda Moreno did, which was called Blessed to Win All Women. And it was so cool. You got to go and listen to it because it's long, it's amazing, it all ties together so perfectly. But what she mainly talked about was Rachel and Hannah and how both of them really longed for the same thing, which was having a baby, but they had very different hearts about it and very different outcomes. So my rendition, okay, my point for today of Linda's lesson is blessed but too obsessed. Blessed but too obsessed. So we're going to just be focusing on Rachel because that's all I have time for. But it's really good. Go on, listen to it. But let's turn to Genesis chapter 30. And a little bit of context, Rachel's husband is Jacob. And Jacob also has another wife called Leah. The Bible says that Jacob's love for Rachel was greater than his love for Leah. So God saw that and he allowed Leah to conceive. But Rachel at that time was barren. In fact, Leah actually ended up having 7 babies. Like, it's a lot. But in Genesis 30, we're going to read verse 1-7. It says, when Rachel saw that she was not bearing Jacob any children, she became jealous of her sister. So she said to Jacob, give me children or I'll die. But Jacob became angry with her and said, am I in the place of God who has kept you from having children? Then she says, here is Bilhah, my servant. Sleep with her so that she can bear children for me and I too can build a family through her. So she gave him her servant Bilhah as a wife. Jacob slept with her, and she became pregnant and bore him a son. Then Rachel said, God has vindicated me. He has listened to my plea and given me a son. Because of this, she named him Dan. Rachel's servant Bilhah conceived again and bore Jacob a second son. So even from this passage, we can see how Rachel's doing. She's desperate. She cried out, give me children or I'll die. Like, this is to the point where she was at. She was obsessed. Obsessed by her one desire. She put it above everything. She idolized having a baby. She idolized having this one dream. And because of this, it affected her walk with God. It affected her joy. It affected the relationship with her husband, and she led him to do some crazy, crazy things. Nothing else really mattered but just to be head down and focused on getting the one thing that she wanted in life, and that's it. And this led to so much competition, even between Rachel and Leah. You know, Rachel gave her servant to Jacob. She had two sons. Then Leah gave her servant to Jacob. She had two sons. I honestly lost track of how many babies they have. Like, imagine them all running around. It would have been crazy at the time. But in verse 21 to 24, let's see what happens. It says, sometime later, she gave birth to a daughter, and her name was Dinah. This is Leah. Then God remembered Rachel. He listened to her and enabled her to conceive. She became pregnant and gave birth to a son and said, God has taken away my disgrace. She named him Joseph and said, may the Lord add to me another son. Wow. She got what she wanted, and that wasn't enough. She got the baby and named him Joseph. And Joseph actually means may he add, which is pretty cool. And then she goes on to say, may the Lord add to me another. Why? Because her original dream, the first thing that she idolized, it didn't fill her up. But it was never meant to. God's blessings add to our life, but they never are supposed to fill us up. We can't get we can't get everything we want, really. But imagine if we could. We can get everything we want, okay? A family, a husband, a dream job, a dream role in the kingdom, maybe. But if we're not truly satisfied with God, we're always going to want more and more and more and more, just like Rachel did. But Rachel learned a hard lesson, and this was one of Linda's points that really stood out to me. It was, be careful what you ask for, because you just might get it. She so longed for another child. But Rachel, she wasn't satisfied, even though she was blessed by God with Joseph. But she became too obsessed. Let's see what happens. In Genesis 35, verse 16, it says, then they moved on from Bethel. While they were still some distance from Ephrath, Rachel began to give birth and had great difficulty. As she was having great difficulty in childbirth, the midwife said to her, don't despair, for you have another son. As she breathed her last, for she was dying, she named her son Ben-Oni, but his father named him Benjamin. She got what she wanted. She got another child, but at what cost? And unfortunately, she died giving birth to this child. And I truly believe that it's because she never got rid of the idols in her life. See, ladies, God is a jealous God. This is serious to God. God smashes idols. But she birthed a baby boy, and she named him Ben-Oni, which means son of my trouble. But I actually find what happens next so beautiful, because Jacob, her husband, named him Benjamin, which means son of my right hand. Jacob knew that God blessed him with Rachel. He was so crazy in love with her. It was so beautiful. But because she was too focused on what she wanted, she was blinded to the blessings right in front of her. You see, idols, they're formed from ungratefulness. Ungratefulness for what you have will always lead you to wanting more. And let me tell you, I know this. Because, to be totally real with you guys, I think ever since I was a little child, my dad would always have this thing with me where he would never tell me he loved me, but he would just buy me stuff. And I knew that the more expensive or whatever it was that he brought me, the more he would love me. So this really came true in my life. I got married almost 2 years ago now, which is crazy. Super grateful. But to be real with you, I'm so embarrassed. I hate it. I learned so much. I didn't really like my engagement ring. Okay, I'm just keeping it real, okay? I was never the kind of person, though, to be like, oh, this is what I want, this is my dream, like, I just didn't really think about it. But the moment I got it, I was like, oh, thank you. Oh, so bad, so bad. And I remember I waited a year, I waited a whole year to build up the courage to tell my husband that I didn't like him. And he's literally the best. He, like, wasn't hurt, he wasn't mad at that moment. And he was like, I just want you to be happy. We'll figure out how to get you a new one one day. We'll save up for it, all this kind of stuff. Anyway, I took that and was like, okay, bet I can get a new one. So the very next day, I went ring shopping. So bad. And I went, and I knew we had a budget, you know what I mean? I figured out where to sell my old one, how much money I would make, like all this kind of stuff. It was so bad. So I found one that wasn't too expensive, but in the store, I loved it. You know how the store has been making it look shinier? Well, I got it, and I stepped outside the store, and I still didn't like it. But I already bought it, and it was already too late, because I put my husband through so much those last couple days. And honestly, I realized that my mindset was like, I want it, I need it now, I have to get it. You know, like that Ariana Grande song, I see it, I like it, I want it, I got it. That was me, but it's so bad. I didn't want to do that. So I really feel like God totally humbled me, because honestly, if you guys just saw how I was acting so entitled, I was acting so prideful, I was acting so impatient, and this was all because of my ungratitude, which led me to idolizing a thing, a belonging, that's not gonna go to heaven with me, honestly. But it was so embarrassing. But I became too obsessed to see that I was already truly blessed. You know, the fact that I even was engaged and got married to the man of my dreams, to the love of my life, was like, that's enough. I didn't need no silly ring to, like, shine or look big or do whatever it was. Like, I literally had everything I need and all the blessings God totally provided. So, ladies, what are you idolizing today? Where have your obsessions led you today? For me, and maybe it's for you too, maybe it's hurting people that you never wanted to hurt. Maybe it's doing things that you said you would never do. Maybe it's trying to do the same thing over and over and over again and expect a different result. You know what the world calls that, ladies? Insanity. Insanity. We have to stop. We have to stop, and we have to just see the blessings right in front of you. And honestly, that's the biggest thing that I took away from this conference. So I have a challenge for you, ladies, okay? It's to write a gratitude list of 100 things you're grateful for by the end of the week. You can find these things in prayer. You can find these things in your little conversations that you have throughout the day. Or you can find it in the huge things that happen in life, like getting a free car like Ambar. Crazy. But we have to realize that God blessed you with all those things already. He is enough. And I really do pray that we can learn from Rachel's really bad example and not be women that are blessed and are too obsessed, but let's be women who are blessed and have gratitude to express. Thank you for letting me share.
Wow, ladies, I don't know what to say after Edie's lesson. That was truly incredible. So as everyone's been saying up here, Chicago was amazing. And I'm so grateful that we all get to participate in the conference next year because it's in LA. Yay! And something that I really got out of the conference is a lesson that Joe Willis did for the Crown of Thorns. And so I'm going to condense it. He did such an amazing job. But I'm going to try to condense it as much as I possibly can. So what I want to do is actually start with going to Matthew 6, verse 33. It's one of my favorite scriptures that has really, it's really gotten me through my entire life as a disciple. Like, I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for that passage, honestly. So Matthew 6, 33, But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. And I think it's so interesting because nowadays we don't really hear the word righteousness or righteous anymore. It's kind of become a byword in our society. It's like, oh, what does this mean? I don't know if I can do that. And I fear that at times it's spoken less and less amongst us as well in the church. And I often hear sometimes in the fellowship, like, yeah, I'm seeking first the kingdom. But I'm like, no, we're seeking first his kingdom. We're seeking first his righteousness. And we often teach, you know, in the first principles that, okay, righteousness is the Bible. But what does righteousness actually mean? So I was, you know, I've heard different versions and different definitions. So of course, you know, you guys know I love definitions. So righteousness in the Greek, it means dikaiosune, which is the state of a woman and what she ought to be, in a condition that is acceptable to God in terms of her doctrine, and having the virtue to do the right thing in every relationship. And so this is what I'm going to talk about tonight, blessed to be righteous. And so, you know, the scriptures call us to hunger and thirst for righteousness. And I don't know, ladies, like, when I fast, I'm starving. I'm like, by the end of the day, I'm like, oh, I can do this. I really need to pray some more. Oh, my gosh. And that's how God wants us to be when it comes to righteousness. He wants us to just grab onto it and can't wait to eat it like some In-N-Out. And it's to please God in every way, shape, and form with our heart and our mind, our body and our soul. It's painstaking. It's paying great attention with great detail to every area of our life to make sure it aligns with the Word of God. And I, you know, Joe was preaching about there's a great difference between being righteous and trying to be righteous. Like, in terms of our sin, we all have different struggles and we all have different sins that we're tempted with. But we have to handle it in a way that we repent radically immediately. And what I mean by this is that we can't deceive ourselves into thinking, like, I can handle this. I don't need to confess it yet. You know, if it becomes a pattern, then I'm going to say something about it. But, you know, I can just chill. I can just calm down about it. But instead, it's like whenever our conscience gets pricked, like, I need to do something about this right now. You know, being righteous is being willing to do whatever is necessary to please God in our relationship with him and be pleasing our relationships with each other. And it's not something that comes naturally. Like Sarah was sharing in terms of friendships, when I first came in the kingdom, I was looking around, I was like, I don't know. I don't know about these people. They show me the truth, but like, I don't know how we're going to do this. And so it takes a denial of self. You know, it takes a constant effort because we're supposed to seek this first. So we're supposed to seek after his righteousness again and again and again and again and again. And so, you know, I want to talk about a few areas where my eyes were really open at the conference about seeking after righteousness. So one of them is getting open when we're hurt by each other. And so typically we go to Matthew 18, verse 15. You know, if your brother or sister sins against you, go and point out their fault just between the two of you. If they listen to you, you've won them over. And of course, we need to obey this passage. It's the Bible. But however, maybe it's just me, but I've been guilty of getting advice before following Matthew 18 and getting in trouble of slandering. Or maybe it's gossiping. Or maybe I don't really need to get open before I need to talk to this person. I just need to get open. I need to pray to God and then just talk to them. And it can lead to sin, it can lead to unrighteousness, and it can lead to a hurtful perspective that another sister has of the sister that they don't need to be having in the first place. You know, God says, like, what does the passage actually say? It says, if someone sins against us, we should bring it up just between the two of us. Like, no one has to know. It's us and God, and that's it. And prayerfully, and 99.9% of the time, it's, my bad, I'm so sorry that I hurt you, and then we're done. And God knows and we know and that's it. But, you know, before Matthew 18, Jesus brings up another principle about winning each other over in Matthew 5, which is a great safeguard. So let's turn to Matthew 5, verse 23. Therefore, if you're offering your gift at the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there in front of the altar. First, go and be reconciled to your brother. Then come and offer your gift. Settle matters quickly. In other words, if we know that someone has something against us, or we're thinking they do, we shouldn't wait for them to bring it to our attention. We should hunt them down in love. Like, I know, like, certain sisters in the room, it's like, you know when I'm pursuing you. You know when I'm coming after you because I love you, and I want to give you that extra hug and, like, look at you, like, what's really going on? And I'm going to sin on it. We need to love each other in that way, even before we worship God on Sunday, to make sure that, like, we're free and clear. There's nothing there. And if the sister's like, no, like, I was having a bad day, you know, I was hungry, whatever. Cool. Okay. But, you know, oftentimes I've seen when a sister has something against us, it weakens her in a way. She's feeling sad. She's feeling hurt. And so she needs more help. And so us going to that sister, it shows care and consideration and love, and it helps her in that weakened state to strengthen her. It helps to strengthen that relationship and just ask, are you okay? Have I hurt you in any way? Are you upset about anything? Is there anything that we need to talk about? And it brings about a great security in the relationship. And instead, like, if we actually went after doing that, everyone feels more loved. Because it also shows you're thinking about that sister. I was thinking about you. You popped in my mind. You popped in my prayer time this morning. Like, are we good? And it's like, oh, I feel so loved. Like, even if I do have something, it's like, oh, this is the time. This is the God-appointed time to bring this thing up. This is great. And so, sisters, I want to challenge you. If you have someone in mind that you're thinking about right now as I'm speaking, please bring it up to this sister before Sunday. It says before you bring your gift to the altar, and that's going to be on Sunday. So I'm going to challenge you. Bring it up to this sister. But the second thing I want to bring up is purity. So real quick, in 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 1, treat younger men as brothers, older women as mothers, and younger women as sisters with absolute purity. So I found out the Greek for absolute means all, like absolute, like it means what it says. But the Greek word for purity is sinlessness of life. It's a cleanliness, it's a chastity. We are to treat each other with a wholehearted purity. And so being righteous in this area, it first calls us to have a purity of mind, to see each other in a clean way, to trust each other's hearts and each other's intentions in terms of everything. And when we're hurt, it's to assume the best of each other instead of assuming the worst. It's like, I saw this, but I'm going to ask you about it and seek to understand. And sometimes it's true, and sometimes it's there, and sometimes it's, sis, I'm so sorry, I was thinking about work. I need to confess, like, I was mad at my boss, I was thinking about this, I was thinking about that, I was just stressed out. But it's having the purity of heart also to completely forgive each other. So it's like, once it's forgiven, it's swept under the rug, just like kids. My kids, they fight all the time, and then they forgive each other, and they're like, I love you forever, and they go off, and they completely forgot about what they were upset about. And it's also blocking anything that comes into our minds that can bring about sin, that can bring about sin in our lives. It's the coarse joking, it's the cursing, it's the K-drama sometimes, it's the books, it's the movies, it's the sex scenes we shouldn't be watching, or maybe the Bridgerton. Like, it's all of it. And of course, we have to have a purity in our speech and our dress code. Like, we should have a heart of mind of no, like, well, I obeyed the rules. It should be about not being a stumbling block to anyone. And so, and I wanna pause this. Every woman in this room is beautiful, gorgeous, captivating. And so I'm gonna share something really embarrassing because Edie, like, you know, she encouraged me to share something really embarrassing. Because she shared something embarrassing. So, you know, I moved here to LA like 9 years ago. And, you know, I was much younger when I moved. I was almost 30. And I felt like, you know, pretty secure in how I look, but when I got to LA, I was like, I don't look like these ladies. Like, I don't have any extensions, and I don't have any eyelashes, and I don't do those things, and I'm not spending money on this. And I felt more and more, like, not ugly, but just kind of homely, like kind of bag lady-ish. And then as I got older, you know, I had a couple kids, and I have stretch marks, and I'm called older all the time, and it's mom, mom, mom. You know, I just saw myself as more and more of a bag lady who was kind of invisible. And I let my dress code be lax. I'd be like, I can go to the gym. Do I have to wear a sweatshirt on my waist? No one's really looking at me anyway. Like, I look homely anyway. But, you know, one night I was walking outside. It was 10:30 at night, and the moon was out, and the stars were sparkling. And Larice completely rebuked me. She let me have it. She was like, sis, you don't know if you're a stumbling block to someone. You don't know what their intention is or what's in their mind. You need to dress accordingly. I was like, I love you, Larice. I love that mental slap. I love that mental slap for me. It was like, well, psh, I was like, ah, I needed that. Because I was thinking about people, and I lost sight of God, about being pure before God. Just like Job. Job, like, you know, offered extra sacrifices for his children just in case they sinned. It's having that type of purity of heart of like, I'm going to make extra sure that we're in the clear here just in case. And so, ladies, like, I just want to challenge you, like, ask your discipler and ask your bestie. You should have several of them. Do you see any impurity in my heart in any area of my life? And then if you do, hold me accountable to it. You know, get that nice little slappy slap like Larise gave to me. And so, ladies, I just want to encourage you all, like, man, it's so great to be part of the kingdom of God, and that, you know, God even gives us the chance to be righteous, because it truly is a blessing. We get to glorify God, and we get to please God with our relationship with him and with each other. So, ladies, thank you so much for letting me share.